My name is Linda Acevedo. I was born and raised here in Seattle, and I came to the hospital for a serious problem with my valve in my heart. It made it so it was almost impossible to lay comfortably on my back. It left me exhausted after only minimal output. I could barely walk more than 300 feet without having to rest. It wasn't shortness of breath like I was running out of oxygen, but it was, I'm so tired, I can hardly breathe. It was very debilitating.
I'm Creighton Don, one of the interventional cardiologists here. I also am the chief of cardiology over at the VA hospital.
My name is Burkhard Mackensen. I'm the director of interventional echocardiography at the University of Washington. I'm also the interim chair of anesthesiology and pain medicine.
My name is Jamie McCabe. I'm the section head of interventional cardiology here at the University of Washington in Seattle.
At the VA, all the faculty there are University of Washington faculty. And, you know, therefore we have privileges in both hospitals. And in particular, I do take my higher risk patients from the VA to the University of Washington. And it's a great relationship because it allows the patients at the VA to have access to the highest level of care in the city or in the state for that matter. So patients at the VA who need access to clinical trials or need more complex procedures, as faculty at the VA, we can bring our patients over to the university and treat them there. The patient we brought over was part of a clinical trial. She was part of the Triluminate study, which is using Abbott's new device for tricuspid clipping. And this is a patient who has been quite sick. She's been in the hospital last year three or four times for heart failure. And you know, on echo, she had this valve that was very dysplastic, had this huge gap with a lot of leaking. You know, we call it torrential tricuspid regurgitation.
Meaning a leaky valve where all the flow goes back into the right atrium. And you see some images behind me that show the turbulent color flow illustrating the severity of tricuspid regurgitation.
In our prior experience with the mitral clip used in the tricuspid valve, we've actually done as many as one or two a week, probably the most in the country. The wonderful thing about developing a clinical trial around Triclip is that the delivery system is more functional, and that's going to allow this to be employed by our whole team here at the University of Washington.
This is the one of the first technologies that are available to treat the tricuspid valve using a percutaneous approach, so using just catheters with the minimally invasive incision. Previously, the only options patients had was open heart surgery. And for patients as we had who didn't qualify for surgery, she wouldn't have almost no options. So with this new device, it's designed specifically for the tricuspid valve. The device is designed to be able to torque and maneuver toward the tricuspid valve and to be oriented toward the tricuspid valve leaflets. And that made it very easy. And so working with Dr. Mackensen, he was able to tell me exactly where he thought the clip should go, and it didn't take me long to navigate the catheter and the clip right to that spot. And that was the major change for this device, not just being studied in the trial.
Well, along with the technical improvement of the device, certainly we also have seen over the last 10 years incredible improvement in our access to technically advanced imaging technology. From my point of view, that includes three-dimensional imaging, but more importantly, the ability to take a 3D image and display it in a multiplanar fashion so that I, as the imager, can understand it, but then use it to guide the interventional cardiologist and illustrate the information so that it's crystal clear to her or him, who is my partner, to guide the procedure and know exactly where we're going to go with the next clip in this particular procedure.
And through the imaging that Dr. Mackensen was able to get, we're able to come up with a plan and exactly where we can position the clips and how to position it and how to orient them. And the series of three clips we placed was all, you know, based on the imaging we're able to get.
And as you see in the images, this really led to a profound reduction. To give you just one number that is critically important, when we look at the footprint of the regurgitant jet at the beginning of the procedure, I measured 4.6 centimeters squared, which is a gigantic hole. At the very end of the procedure, we had it reduced to 0.18 centimeter squared. Again, 4.6 to 0.18, just incredibly effective in the reduction.
We started out as part of the partner study with the first transcatheter heart valves in the region about 12 years ago. We moved to other transcatheter heart valves and the mitraclip procedure, the Watchman procedure, and now the tricuspid clipping procedure is part of the Triluminate study. And we're going to be moving on towards this EVOKE study using the Edwards transcatheter heart valve for the tricuspid position. It's been a long history here at the University of Washington, and we're seeing it bear its fruit.
When the procedure was over, I noticed basically immediately that I could be flat. I could be flat in bed, and that it felt comfortable. Like my back said, thank you. You've been sleeping with me bent for years. Now it's comfortable. The change in my sort of zest for living has gone up dramatically because I'm not tired. That I can't hardly lift a fork. Feeling is gone. And I am so thankful that this clip and the procedure has worked so smoothly for me. The stitches were little tiny things and have not been painful. One day and one night in the hospital and I'm fixed. This repair has been the biggest blessing in my life. I am very grateful to the team of people who invented it, designed and built it, and learned to use it. I feel honored that I'm a recipient of this repair procedure. Thank you.